This video is sponsored by Truefire. Over 2 million guitar players worldwide improve their playing using Truefire's online lesson systems. Learn, practice, and play with Truefire. Hi, this is Keith Williams. Welcome to 5-Watt World. We're interested in helping you get the most music from the least gear. In 1977, my brother, who's a year older than me, got his first car, a black Ford Rambler coupe. I remember seeing the road fly by through the holes in the rusted out floorboards. We'd installed the best stereo system we could find in that remote corner of upstate New York, a Pioneer 8-track player with four Jensen speakers. Taking Care of Business by BTO and 4-Play Long Time from Boston's first record would blast from those overworked speakers. We couldn't afford to buy many tapes, so we'd borrow them from friends. One day, Brian brought back a batch from a guy in town. We had no idea what was in the box, but it was new music to us, and that was enough. I pulled one from the box at random and threw it in. And this is what we heard. Okay, here's the problem with poetic memory. It's often wrong. It was 1977, and it was an old Ford Rambler, but Rush didn't release Tom Sawyer until 1981's Moving Pictures. And, to top it off, though Geddy Lee would play his Rickenbacker on tour into the mid-80s, the song was actually recorded with his Fender jazz bass. Now, in my own defense, in the pre-internet world of the late 70s, all I knew came from a few pictures of Lee with that black 4001 in some magazines live. Just be careful what you think you remember. But either way, Rush was my introduction to the power of a Rickenbacker bass guitar. Somehow it's taken me all these years to double back to learn the real history of an instrument that was launched in 1957. So if you too have always wondered about the story of a bass that was at one time the foundation of the Beatles, yes, Rush and Metallica, stay tuned, because this is the 5-Watt World short history of the Rickenbacker bass guitar. If you enjoy our videos, take a minute to subscribe and hit the bell icon to be notified when we put out new videos. We always want to give you choices, so there's now three ways you can support 5-Watt World. Choose a Patreon level to support us on an ongoing basis and be part of an exclusive live stream, or early have early access to videos. Grab a t-shirt, hoodie, the Short Histories video bundle, or a Stomp preset pack from the store, or simply make a donation down in the tip jar in the description. If you enjoy our videos, find the best way of supporting us that best fits your life. And thanks in advance. You folks are 5-Watt World. I just make the videos. Adolf Rickenbacker was born in Basel, Switzerland in 1887, but moved to the U.S. with his family and settled in Los Angeles. By the time he was 31, he'd established a successful tool and die firm, stamping out metal and plastic parts, and by the late 1920s, making parts for local guitar companies had become a major part of his business. National String Instrument Corporation was a neighboring firm in Los Angeles and was a big customer. It's debated whether George Beekamp invented the cone system that defines a resonator guitar, but in any case, George became general manager at National. He was still looking for ways to make guitars louder, and this meant looking for a way to amplify the instrument. They built a working version of a lap steel guitar on a slab of maple with the pickup as a proof of concept. This is what's called the wood frying pan guitar, so named because of the small round section and long handle-like neck. This was in 1931, and it is correctly thought of as the first electric guitar. They filed a patent application for the pickup in 1934, and it was granted in August of 37. And to just get this covered, to distance his name from what was happening in Germany between the wars, Adolf anglicized the pronunciation of the company name from Rickenbacker to Rickenbacker. Though most of us get it wrong at one time or another, I tend to mix it up all the time, the company had decided to use Rickenbacker as early as the mid-30s. But back to our story. In 1942, Electro stopped producing musical instruments and began producing items for the war effort. In 1946, they were starting to get back into the instrument business. By then, Adolf Rickenbacker had turned 60 years old and had grown tired of the instrument business and started looking around for someone to buy the company. Enter Francis Carey Hall, or F.C. Hall as he's generally known. Hall's company was one of the early distributors of Fender guitars and amps and had been part of launching the Fender Telecaster and Precision Bass in 1950. It was this exposure to the booming solid-body guitar industry that got F.C. interested in owning his own instrument company. So in late 1953, Hall bought Electro String Music from the Rickenbackers. As part of the deal, Hall could continue to use the Rickenbacker name. Hall's entry into the guitar business soon ended his arrangement with Fender, as now he was part of the competition. Hall launched into modernizing Rickenbacker, and in early 1954, he hired Roger Rossmeisel. Ross Mozell had learned about building guitars from his father back in Germany, and after the war he decided to emigrate to the U.S. He'd spent a year working for Ted McCarty at Gibson in Michigan, and had been there during the launch of the Les Paul in 1952. But McCarty was not interested in Ross Mozell's designs, so he then moved to Southern California and went to work at Rickenbacker. And so by the mid-50s, all the players were in place to design and build the first Rick bass guitars. In 1957, the Model 4000 appeared on the price list. It shows the influence of Ross Mozell's design style, and it had the now familiar yet angular body and the cresting wave headstock. It was the first bass guitar to follow Fender's use of a 34-inch scale with something close but unique at 33.5 inches. There was a clear plastic pickguard painted gold on the back. Chrome knobs controlled volume and tone. The body was unbound and with an unbound fingerboard with 20 frets and with 8-dot inlays and shallow tuners. There was a clear plastic finger rest below the strings. Supposedly, this placement was based on Leo Fender's idea that upright players would rest there and play with their thumb. Only available in maple glow and the older style two-tone, browner, fire glow finishes. It was the first production bass guitar with a neck through the body construction, where the neck continues for the entire length of the body as a single unit, and the body is glued to the neck. These side sections of the body and headstock are often referred to as wings. The neck, through design, is supposed to increase resonance as the tuners, pickup, bridge, and strings are all in a single piece of wood. Ross Mozell had first introduced neck-through construction on the earliest Rick guitars. Though by 1956, Rickenbacker was moving away from using their horseshoe pickups on their guitars, the 4000 bass's unique sound comes from this pickup design. The horseshoe pickup had been developed for the earliest electric guitars, the massive curved magnets giving it its name. It was Rick's first pickup, and it might even be the first pickup design used on an electric guitar of any kind. Designed to be put on everything from hollow body guitars to lap steels, along with the maple neck through construction, the horseshoe pickup is a big part of the Rickenbacker bass's cutting tone. The horseshoe has a single coil-sized bobbin wrapped in copper wire with four adjustable pull pieces down the middle. The uniqueness comes in that the bobbin resides in the middle of two massive cobalt-infused steel magnets bent into a U-shape. Not only do the magnets encompass the entire bobbin assembly, but the bass strings run through the middle of them as well. This completely surrounds the strings with a magnetic field. The punchy-sounding horseshoe became the foundation of the Rickenbacker 4000 bass sound. In 1957, the 4000 model sold for $279.50, which was $60, or fully 20% more than a Fender Precision cost that year. It's good to remember that in the late 50s, Rick was a very small instrument company, and accordingly produced small batches of guitars. Like other Rick models, the basses evolved from batch to batch. By 58, the necks were being made out of solid walnut, and a white pickguard was offered as an option. 59 saw the neck width narrowed slightly. 60 saw both walnut and mahogany neck bases built, and a redder sunburst or fire glow was offered. By the end of that year, a maple neck with walnut wings on the headstock became standard. In 1961, the body became more contoured and was slightly slimmer. 63 saw a number of changes. They introduced a black or jet glow and brown burst or autumn glow finishes. A white pickguard became standard, replacing the gold. Black Bakelite knobs replaced the black and chrome, and this stabilized the model for a while as their attention went to building other guitar models. In 69, the 4000 got the new high-gain pickup, with a solid cover replacing the split cover of the older horseshoe bridge pickup. The headstock was shortened slightly as well, and in 1970 a set neck design replaced the neck through. Grover closed-back tuners were used from 71 to 75, after which Schuyler open-back tuners were used again. In 1984, the 4000 model was removed from the price list, and the final guitars seemed to have been trickled out from the factory from 85 until 86. Back in 61, Rick introduced a new deluxe two-pickup version as the 4001. Originally designed for use with flat-wound strings, the neck pickup had been added to improve bass response and provide a wider tonal flexibility. It had a bound body and a bound rosewood fingerboard, though the factory sometimes used ebony on particularly fancy instruments. There were triangle inlays made of crushed pearl, and the two pickups had separate volume and tone controls. They were bound with a checkerboard black and white Rickenbacker Deluxe binding. At their introduction, they were only available in the fire glow finish. The 4001's evolution followed much the same as the 4000's across the 60s, with the changes in knobs and available finishes. The original neck pickup in the 4001 is generally referred to as the toaster pickup, and is the one that adorned both Chris Squire's and Paul McCartney's original and signature basses. It got its name from the toaster-shaped pickup cover, and in construction, it's very different than the later high-gain pickup model. The toaster's construction is more akin to a Strat-style pickup, with its separate pole pieces, where the high-gain would adopt a large bar magnet, more like a P90 design. In sound, that comparison carries forward, with the toaster being airier and the high-gain having more girth. An excellent example of the sound of a toaster pickup is the intro to Yes's Roundabout. In the late 60s, the stereo Ricosound wiring first became available, appearing on the price list as an official option in 1971. This wiring allows you to send the neck pickup to one rig and the bridge pickup to another. This is how Chris Squire used it, much to the confusion of all the bass players that were chasing his tone. According to Richard Smith's book, Rickenbacker, there were also some unusual 4001s built, at least three 30-inch scale instruments, and in 1965 the factory built some six-string 4001s. The horseshoe pickup had had one challenge. Because of its location in the bridge, it didn't have as much low end as players needed. And so between 69 and 71, they introduced the Rickenbacker high-gain single-coil pickup. Despite the name, the high-gain pickup was also a guitar pickup and is actually one of the lowest output bass pickups Rickenbacker offers. Though the high-gain pickup wasn't as powerful, its tone, in combination with its neck position placement, perfectly complemented the horseshoe. Now players like Chris Squire and Rush's Geddy Lee could dial in the perfect amount of warm, mid-range focused lows while still cutting right through the mix. By the early 70s, they'd started building some guitars with set neck instruments along with the neck through design. In 72, the contrasting walnut wings on the headstock were replaced by maple with a walnut stripe running the length of the instrument. 72 also saw the completion of the transition to the high-gain pickup, and the clear plastic finger rest below the strings was finally removed. 73 saw a move to single-color white or black body binding and away from the classic checkerboard Ric binding. The triangle inlays switched to slightly smaller perloid, replacing the larger crust pearl triangles that year as well. In the mid-70s, Ric dropped the original horseshoe pickup design in favor of a traditional under-the-strings design, and this can be seen in the 1975 catalog. It retained the chrome cover, but many players found the cover in the way and removed it. The initial run of 4001s ran until 1984 and were then discontinued, except for reissues. The best-known 4001 is likely Paul McCartney's 1964 4001S. The S here stood for special, but it might have well stood for simplified, as it was a simple version of the new 2 pickup model. It was an export model sold only in Europe and by the UK distributor Rose Morris. It had the horseshoe bridge pickup, toaster neck pickup, unbound body, and fingerboard. A left-handed version was made for Paul McCartney, and he used it with the Beatles on the 1965 American tour. Distinctively, it had a left-handed body, but a right-handed neck, and so the headstock is upside down. Originally a fire glow finish, it was later painted with a psychedelic finish around the time of the Magical Mystery Tour, and then later stripped back to maple and reshaped the body slightly, rounding the top edge for playing comfort. It was used from that point forward by McCartney, including his recording and touring with his post-Beatles band, Wings. Of course, McCartney's use of the Ric, along with the use of Ric guitars by Harrison and Lennon, led to the explosion in demand for Rickenbacker guitars that really was the wave of the company's greatest success and the years of production in the 60s. When Rickenbacker started doing reissues in the early 80s, they built a 4001 V63, model mimicking many of the features of McCartney's 4001S. Though like other early 80s Ricks reissues, it's not built to the exact original specs. It was introduced in 1984 and continued in production in one form or another until the present 4003S model. There was a later specific copy of the McCartney bass for the Japanese market named the 4001 V63 PMC, Paul McCartney, model. Introduced around 1984, it remained in production into the early 2000s. Notably, it had the flipped headstock of the instrument originally built for Paul with a left-handed body and that right-handed neck. The other most famous 4001 is also a 4001S, the one that was played by Chris Squire of Yes. For most of his career, Chris's constant companion was a modified 64 4001S. The original was a 1965 model and was produced as a limited reissue later from 91 till 2000. Chris wired his 4001 with a stereo output, allowing him to send the bridge and neck pickups to different signal paths. A big fan of effects pedals, Chris would often treat the bridge pickup output with distortion and modulation effects while leaving the neck pickup output dry to maintain its low end. That inevitable Chris Squire reissue looked outwardly much like the McCartney reissue, except that it featured African vermilion headstock wings, and had a clear plastic pickguard that was painted white on the back with Squire's signature. It also featured the more rounded neck profile of Squire's original instrument, and it was only available in cream color glow. Besides McCartney and Squire, most classic Rick tones were created with the later 4001 basses. Rush's Geddy Lee's relationship with Rickenbacker basses began in 1973 with his purchase of a Jet Glow Rickenbacker 4001. In an interview, Geddy admitted that when he bought his first Rick, he was chasing Chris Squire's sound. Geddy's 4001 had some player-specific modifications, including the installation of a Leo Kwan Badass 2 bridge and the removal of the bridge pickup cover. Though Geddy often used a Fender Jazz Bass in the studio from 75 to 84, it was the Rickenbacker 4001, with which Geddy spent most of his time on stage. Motorhead founder Lemmy admitted when it came to selecting the Rickenbacker 4001 bass as his primary instrument, it was all about the looks. Lemmy swapped out his pickups to get the powerful bass grind he sought. His first Rickenbacker 4001 was loaded with Gibson Thunderbird pickups, which Lemmy claimed in a 2015 interview with Bass Player magazine sounded like a, quote, "f***ing bulldozer," end quote. Lemmy was loyal to Rickenbacker basses throughout his career, appearing with several iconic Ricks, from his modified Maple Glow Rickenbacker 4001, featuring star inlays and a Born to Lose Out to Lunch sticker, to his signature 4004 LK Rickenbastard. Limited to 60 pieces, the 4004 LK had a walnut body with a hand-carved relief of oak leaves and was stacked with three Rickenbacker humbucking pickups. Like other proponents of the Rick bass sound, Lemmy would play with a pick, mixing lead style playing with his brutal fast and rock solid rhythmic chops. In a hard rock and metal context, Cliff Burton of Metallica exclusively played a heavily modified Burgundy Glow Rickenbacker 4001 during Metallica's early days. Like Lemmy, Burton swapped out the stock pickups of his 4001 and replaced them with a unique custom set, including a Gibson EBO humbucker in the neck position, a Seymour Duncan stacked jazz pickup in the bridge position, and a Seymour Duncan stacked Stratocaster pickup wedged into the bass's bridge cavern. Burton pulled from a diverse musical interest ranging from classical and jazz to country and southern rock. One of the more visible rockers using a Rick today is bassist and singer Charles Michael Parks Jr. of All Them Witches. Mostly seen through the years with his cobbled-together 74 4001 running it through a Sovtek MIG 100 amp. The bass has featured heavily on every album, and despite looking like it's been run over by a truck, has been used extensively on tour as well. While Parks is primarily a fingerstyle player, his bass playing is at times almost a hybrid between six-string guitar and bass styles, doubling or counterpointing the band's guitar melodies or filling as much space as a bassist and a rhythm guitar during guitar solos. Other famous wielders of 4000 series basses include Roger Glover of Deep Purple, Michael Rutherford of Genesis, Phil Lynott of Thin Lizzy in the early years, and Paul Simonon of The Clash. In 1980, the 4003 model replaced the 4001. It included a new truss rod designed to be used with wound ground strings. The truss rods were adjusted at the body until 1985, when the adjustment point was moved to the headstock. Early in the 1980s, the Fireglow finish moved to a three-color black-red-yellow finish. A fretless 4003 FL model was introduced, and a 4003 S model that took its styling cues from the original 4000 S basses when introduced, and though it was discontinued in the 90s, it's back in the current catalog. An immensely important 4003 player is Al Cisneros of the band Sleep and later Ohm. Starting with Holy Mountain in Jerusalem, Sleep would bridge the gap from stoner rock to doom metal by taking the Black Sabbath playbook and slowing it way, way down. After Sleep split, Ohm would record several albums where Cisneros' bass playing would play an even more prominent role. And Al has gotten his own signature model, the 4003 AC. 1987 saw the introduction of the 4003S/5, Rick's first five-string bass, essentially a 4003S with an added low B string. The same year, an eight-string version of the 4003S was introduced, and both of these models are still in production. Despite the dominance of the 4000 series, Rickenbacker made other basses over the years. 1965 saw a 4005 semi-hollow Rick bass model added. These thin-line basses were in the response to the success of other semi-hollow basses doing well in the market at the time, like the Hofner basses. The body was based on the 360/375 model guitars. They had rounded top edges and double cutaways. There were two pickups and deluxe appointments, like a bound neck and triangle inlays. 21-fret rosewood fingerboard necks, and the first were available in Fire Glow and Maple Glow finishes. In the 70s, they became available in other standard color glow finishes. They had the slash sound hole and the R tailpieces. Famously, John Entwistle of The Who played a 4005 light show bass early in the band's history. Like the light show guitars, the light show instruments had a plastic top through which lights mounted inside the guitar would show and change in reaction to the music. The factory also made a few 8-string versions of this model, the 4005-8, with pairs of strings tuned in octaves, which had an altered headstop shape to accommodate the 8 tuners. 1970 saw the introduction of the 3000 models, which were listed and then very quickly dropped from the catalog to be replaced by the 3001 model in 75. The 3001 ran until 1984. Initially a 20-fret bass with a 30-inch scale length, they later switched to a version with a 33.5-inch scale. They were built in either black or brown-stained natural maple. And finally, introduced in 1984, the final model, 2030, also called the Hamburg bass. A slab-sided body bass with an offset headstock and body similar to the Capri guitars from the earliest years of Rick. The two pickups had volume and tone controls, and there was an active tone circuit. They also released a model 2050 deluxe version of the 2030 with body and neck binding. These basses were introduced at the time that Rick was wading into the reissue game along with Fender, and in a few years Gibson would follow suit. Much of their current production since has been copies of the instruments that were made in the earliest days of the brand. I've partnered with Truefire because I've used them for over a decade. My playing always improves when I put in the time on their lessons. Whether you're a beginner, intermediate, or professional level player, Truefire has lessons to inspire and advance your playing. As you know, I always promote spending money on lessons before new gear. I really like Truefire, and I think if you give them a shot, you'll like them too. Get 25% off courses with the promo code 5Watt25, or like I have for many years, sign up for the All Access Pass to use the entire Truefire catalog. You can sample anything in the catalog with the All Access Pass and see where the muse takes you. I'd like to thank Truefire for partnering with me and sponsoring this video. In 1989, the company brought its manufacturing and offices back into the same building on the corner of South Main and Stevens Streets in Santa Ana, California, where it remains to this day. They upgraded the facility, and this led to many improvements in manufacturing. By the mid-90s, following along with another surge in sales, the factory had grown back to near mid-60s levels, with between 60 and 85 employees. When asked why Rickenbacker hasn't offered any new models in decades, ancestor of F.C. Hall, John Hall, generally points out that Rickenbacker has such a backlog of orders for their traditional models, they've never really felt they had production capacity to build something new. A couple of years ago, a member of 5Watt World reached out to me, and in short order, we were on Zoom talking guitars. I was fascinated because though he's lived in France since the mid-90s, he's always collected Ricks. He told me though he loves living and working in France, he's drawn to Ricks because they are a tie to his roots back in America. And in this, I think he has it right. Though they are heavily associated with the British invasion bands, Rickenbacker is perhaps the most quintessentially American guitar company. If I missed your favorite part of the Rickenbacker bass story, please put it in the comments for everyone to enjoy. I know from experience that I can count on you. I need to thank Ron O'Keefe of Ron's Vintage Guitars. When searching for pictures of vintage Rick basses, I kept seeing his site pop up, and I reached out for permission to use the pics. He not only gave me his permission, he reviewed the video and gave me lots of feedback and corrections that I incorporated in the video where I could. Ron's working on a new book outlining the history of the Rickenbacker brand, and I'll feature it here on the channel when it comes out. I need to thank the folks at Anderton's Music in the UK for permission to use the clips of Nathan and Lee from their All About Bass series. Like most of you, I've long enjoyed the gear-soaked content pouring from Anderton's, and they were very complimentary of 5Watt World while giving their permission to boot. Two texts were instrumental in pulling together my research: The Bass Book by Tony Bacon and Barry Morehouse, and Richard Smith's Rickenbacker, A Complete and Illustrated History. Both books are listed in the description. I need to thank Perry McManus for helping out with his knowledge of more current Rick bass players. If the reference is dark and heavy, you can bet Perry slid it into the script when I wasn't looking. And finally, I need to thank the guys that built and maintained Ricksource website for details on the evolution of the 4000 series models over the years. I need to thank all of you that have purchased the Short History Season 1 bundle, a t-shirt, a hoodie, or tossed something into the tip jar. You keep 5Watt World running. And in particular, I need to thank the members of Friends of 5Watt on Patreon. I really appreciate you folks being along for the ride and supporting 5Watt World. If you enjoyed this short history of the Rickenbacker bass, hit the like button. And if you haven't subscribed yet, go ahead and hit that too. Thanks for watching. Until next time, I'm Keith Williams. Thanks for being a part of the 5Watt World.